All right, so I'm trying something new and modern today. I'm gonna play Demir Mill. This may wind up being a short stream as I only have planned one modern league, but you know, sometimes that can take a while. But yeah, hello, welcome. I'm gonna record this as a video for Channel Fireball YouTube channel, which means shout out to my two excellent sponsors. The first, of course, is ChannelFireball.com. I just published a deck guide with Modern Mill, so if you want to pair the video content with written content, you can consider signing up for CFB Pro. We're really putting out a lot of modern content and then looking ahead towards Adventures in the Forgotten Realms, so this is a good time to look into it, and we have tons of different offers that can fit your circumstances, budget, whatever it might be. If you do decide to look into CFB Pro or do any other business with Channel Fireball, please remember my affiliate code Reid, R-E-I-D. And thank you also to Ultimate Guard. This is, if you're a paper Magic player, ideal time to be looking into the storage, transportation, protection of your, you know, beloved Magic collection, as there might be more opportunities to play paper Magic on the horizon. And Ultimate Guard's the place to do that. So check out their online catalog. If you're here with me live on stream, I have information about Ultimate Guard in the panels below my stream and in my chat in the commands. By the way, Tommy GG, thank you so much for gifting that sub. That's really generous of you, and welcome to Smilotron. All right, Demir Mill. This deck is cool and fun. It's gotten a lot of major upgrades over the past like year and a half or so, and the latest of which is Fractured Sanity from Modern Horizons 2, and of course Counterspell. So I'm gonna run this through League. Let's do it. Yeah, thanks for thanks to everybody for coming from all over the world, particularly if you're way out east. I know the time zones don't always line up well, but I appreciate your dedication. Happy to have you here. Plaz is on break from university and doing tons of bouldering, climbing. That's awesome. Hope you enjoy it. Keep it up. Greetings from Argentina. Hello from New York. And Mug, thank you so much for the sub and the great question. How do I feel about Ragavan in Modern? I think it's awesome. I think it's one of the best one-mana creatures ever printed. And if you want to be like an aggressive or tempo-based deck, touching into the color red, you want to consider the Legendary Monkey. Core asks, how do I feel about fairies, tempo slash control in Modern? Well, I guess I'll take that is a two-part question. I think tempo slash control is a great approach. Kind of like cheap threats and disruption. That's going to be really effective in Modern. As to whether fairies is, you know, at the power level of the other Modern decks, that's a more difficult question because, you know, fairies was awesome back in the Lorwyn era. But since that time, like the power level of the rest of the format has risen quite dramatically, and fairies hasn't gotten all those big upgrades, so we shall see. All right, round number one, Demir Mill. So this looks like just about how I want to start. Turn one, Hedron Crab, good mix of lands and spells, Fractured Sanity, which can be cycled or hardcast, and then Surgical Extraction. This is more of like a support card. Don't necessarily need to have it in your opening hand, but with the rest of my cards all perfectly in place, I'm thrilled with this. Hello. Chancellor of the Forge, you may reveal this from your opening hand. If you do, at the beginning of your first upkeep, create a 1-1 red Phyrexian Goblin creature token with haste. So what do I make of this? It's either like a super aggressive red goblins deck, or it's some kind of combo reanimator deck. I'll be chat saying it's a Warp World deck. Well, we'll see. I got some counter spells. I could be ready for Warp World. Okay, you're going to exile that Chancellor of the Forge, and you're going to play Fury Evoked. Fair enough. Just gonna main phase cycle, because if I hit a key combo piece, I can choose to extract it. I guess I can do it on my opponent's upkeep. I don't see any downside in that. Or right now. Wave Sifter, Tireless Provisioner. Sure. Glimpse of Tomorrow. So chat guessed it right. When this comes off suspend, we're going to shuffle all permanents into our libraries, reveal how many cards from the top, put all non-aura permanent cards onto the battlefield. Okay, but notably this does not reshuffle graveyards. Okay, to cycle or to hard cast? Think I'm going to cycle because I'm feeling like I need some action at this point. Need to find a counter spell, basically. Okay, so I did mill a Glimpse of Tomorrow, but it's too late to extract it. I can extract it if my opponent plays a Cascade card. Ticking time bomb. Yuck. Definitely flooding out a bit. I guess I'll just reach for the Lurrus. All right, I really can't do anything here. I can port some more permanents on the battlefield, and then maybe I will spike a bunch of crabs and lands with the glimpse. Oh no, this is one-sided. So it's not like there are some of these cards that are not that are symmetrical. I mean, if I try to take away, like, if I try to extract the Chancellors and the Omnaths, is that going to be helpful? All right, I think I probably want to... There's two each of Chancellor of the Forge and Omnath remaining in the opponent's battle library. So I think I want to, right now, surgical extract the Chancellor, and then I can potentially just decide later on the second surgical extraction. Chat is split. I said extract Chancellor, and then chat says extract Omnath. Another person says extract Dark Dwellers. So they actually have a Dark Dwellers in hand. So much, and then there's also a Shardless Agent. So my choice here is, like, I can just try to extract as much of the big stuff as I can, or I can try to extract the Glimpse of Tomorrow itself, and then the Dark Dwellers and the Shardless Agents won't really have much that they can hit. Tricky. I think I probably just get the Dark Dwellers. Plus, I just can't resist the value of getting a card out of my opponent's hand with surgical extraction. All right, let's see what bad things happen to me. Maybe we'll just hit 9 lands. Okay, that looks like it wasn't as bad as it could have been. This is a mandatory discard too, so that Shardless Agent's going to be gone. Unless they crack the clue first, which they can do. Let's do it all again. So I have faded that last Omnath. That's good. Are we doing it again? Here we go. Still no Omnath, and my opponent's library is dwindling. I mean, it looks as though I'm going to get another turn, and if I get another turn, I have a number of outs to win the game, you know? At this point, am I surgical extracting like violent outburst? Because that would actually kill me. Just surgical extract violent outburst and then try to block. I meant to respond to my own trigger there, because I could have basically milled one more card if I'd extracted that burst first. Omnath might not even be that problematic because it's unclear if they have three lands left in their library to even make land drops. I'm going to go after the Violent Outburst. That's my instinct here. All right, they have basically just some more creatures, and Omnath can't trigger the third ability, so I think I'm going to get at least another turn. Oh wow, would I have just won if I had surgicaled before my land drop? That's annoying. I think I'm gonna win anyway, if I'm not missing something. They can make another two tokens at the end of the turn, but the lifelink from Lyris puts me in decent shape. Block the biggest two. take 11 but gain 3. All right, that was close and interesting. Just what we want from our first game. Well, I'd say these are the only, these are the definites. And then Ashiok and Ensnaring Bridge make me lose Luris, which I'm not that excited about. Maybe like Damnation is okay. Yeah, I brought in one lantern. Can't really be too bad to have one lantern. This hand is virtually perfect. Short of having, like, you know, the quadruple archive trap hand, this is as good as you can get. So this stops a lot of my stuff, but not everything. And I guess I'll just start milling myself because I have Visions and Luris. That's fine. It's just shock with steam vents. What's going on here? Suspend Glimpse. Okay, you got it. Seems like they might have Mystical Dispute because they shocked in response to the crab. Then maybe they reread it and realized that Leyline stops it. I don't know, just a theory. 14 cards in my graveyard. End of turn, we're going to go for a draw three. I'm also going to end of turn Surgical Mystical Dispute. I rarely do an end of turn Surgical Extraction. That's kind of like not usually the best timing for this card. But since it's specifically Mystical Dispute and my mana is going to go to waste anyway, okay, they have a bunch of difficult to cast cards in hand. They do have four disputes. They brought in four disputes, four ley lines. They trimmed on Dark Dwellers. Oh no, they just have... Yeah, I guess they trimmed one Dark Dwellers. If there's any way I'm supposed to let this resolve. I think I'm actually going to let this resolve, as strange as that sounds. Because it gets rid of the ley line. And the problem is, if I counter this in my opponent's upkeep and then they just draw land and play Dark Dwellers, it's really bad for me. I understand they might get another ley line. They might get a lot of different things. I might just die outright, but I think my odds of winning are better by letting it resolve. And yeah, that's mostly a downgrade, I think. I wonder if I should just be killing my own crabs. Not quite yet, I don't think. Surgical, yep. So notably, I'm forced to mill myself with these Hadrian Crabs, and I'm down to 11 cards in my library. Can I afford to play one more land here? Then probably drown and lock my own crab. I think not. I think I'm going to pass. And then surgical the glimpse in my opponent's draw step. Hey, Deathrite, thank you so much for subscribing. Okay, my opponent's still a mana off of casting anything. It's a race against my own clock. I milled my opponent's island, which means they probably have one island, one mountain, I guess. Oh, that was a great draw. All right. So how many basics do I have left in my deck? My deck list has 5 basics. 1, 2, 3, 4. So I should have one island left, which means that I can trigger landfall twice this turn, which means I cannot deplete my opponent's library, which means what? That I just play a Ruined Crab and make one land drop. Let's see if I mill my Fractured Sanity. It's the only relevant card. Oh, I have one Ruin Crab also. So I milled my Fractured Sanity and my Ruin Crab. Milling the Ruin Crab could wind up being good, though. So assuming my opponent doesn't have any relevant card to play, I just barely am going to beat them here by playing the fourth Ruin Crab and making a land drop. And then both our libraries will be at zero, but that's good enough because they'll draw first. A 0-0 victory. All right. Got him. Right, the interesting dynamic of that game is that Ruin Crab says each opponent, Hedron Crab says target player. Because of the Leyline of Sanctity, the Hedron Crabs had to mill me, so it was like my Ruin Crab army was racing my Hedron Crab army to see who would die first. Correct. My opponent couldn't attack me because then I could chump block with the Hedron Crabs. You consider Mill to be a villain deck? Well, everyone knows that Jund is the only good guy, and every non-Jund deck is a villain deck. Jund against the world. But actually, I like Mill because it's really good against what people would consider to be some of the villain decks, like the ramp stuff, are good matchups. You know, Titan and Tron are good matchups for Mill. All right, another excellent hand. Bauble. Do I want to Archive Trap immediately, even though it gives them like opportunity to turn to delve? I guess. I guess I'll wait. No, the Lurrus is mine. This is my companion, not theirs. So I'm expecting them to have large delve creatures. Okay, I think I'm gonna not play Ruin Crab because it'll just die to Lightning Bolt in all likelihood. So, Watery Grave tapped. You notice what my opponent did there is they looked at their own top card, and then they can choose the order of the Delver trigger and the Bauble trigger to maximize their chances of flipping into Insect Aberration. All right, that is a reasonable clock. Or an unreasonable clock, depending on whom you ask. Jake DeFord, thank you for subscribing. Wow. So I'm just going to be dead on turn four. Turn four kill on the play from a Delver deck. They might even have a counter spell to throw in too. Yeah, I just can't do anything right against three flyings. Hypothetically, if I could draw a card with Visions of Beyond, is there even anything I could draw? Fatal Push. All right, I had a good hand. I got to play some spells, but it was not remotely close. I don't even know if Crypt Incursion is going to be good if they can delve away their stuff. How much life can I expect to gain from a profane memento? Probably not a huge amount. One thing is boarding in the bridge makes me lose Luris, which is bad news. I don't know, let's try it. I think this is a bad matchup. It's kind of like the more fair an opposing deck is, the worse a matchup it is for Mill. Berta likes Aether Gust and Mystical Dispute as sideboard cards. I could definitely see that. I copied this deck list from a Magic Online player named The Enzyme. Probably the best thing I could have for this matchup is just like more fatal pushes, more removal spells. Mr. Fluff and Stuff, thank you so much for subscribing. And Bear, thank you also. Oh, 2 mana for a 7/7 flying. Look how far we've come. I think Crypt Incursion probably stinks in this matchup too because of the delve. I should have likely just had a Profane Memento in place of the Crypt Incursion. Or I should have some more sideboard cards for this matchup. Yep, not great. Not great. All right, quick and decisive. Do I think people will adjust to the Urza Saga decks? In some amount. I think Urza Saga is just a really, really strong card. It's a type of card where like you can design your deck to have a fair fighting chance against it, but it's not really exploitable. The cost of putting it in your deck is too low. So I don't think people are gonna like I don't think there's gonna be like an anti-Urza Saga deck, you know? What's the best thing you can do? Put Ancient Grudge in your sideboard or something. I think Urza Saga is just going to continue to be a very strong card for as long as it's legal. Intrepid Gamer, thank you for subscribing. Urkel's recall is effective. Yeah, for sure. Definitely effective against the constructs. But again, it's like they didn't you Urkel's recall, you get rid of all their constructs, but they didn't really have to invest a lot of resources in making them. So you're getting like nice board presence and tempo exchange, but you're not really punishing them in terms of card advantage. This hand is acceptable. This is like probably the bottom of the range of hands that I should be keeping here. Because even if I do find my lands, it's not like it's some amazing hand. It's just I get to play a crab and then sit on some counterspells. Pretty borderline, I'd say. Interesting, they take one of the counter spells. I was feeling like that was the least valuable card in my hand. Oh, geez. All right. Not great. I could drown in the lock the priest. Or I could just take my medicine, let the Archon enter the battlefield, and then drown in the lock the Archon at the end step. Wow, Rogue Agent, thank you so much for gifting those subs above and beyond the Call of Duty. And if you were gifted a sub, I'm happy to have you here. Alamora, thanks for your continued support. Well, if my opponent just never casts anything, I could win. And Regis and Jodo, thank you also. A lot of love today, I appreciate it. All right, here's my opponent's graveyard. All four copies of Priest of the Fell Rites, and then a bunch of reanimation targets. No unburial rites or anything like that. So I'm hoping to fade a fifth land right now. Fatal Push. I am okay with that. If I fade that fifth land, I'm liking my position. They have not milled any equipment yet. Their hand must be just be full of equipment. Or they're terrified of Archive Trap. I guess I'm going to go for draw step Field of Ruin because maybe they don't have a fetchable land yet left. They have four swamps showing. I'm going to guess they probably have one plains, but I think it's worth trying. Oh, I meant to draw step it, but I accidentally upkeeped it. Maybe it was bad to use my Field of Ruin there because now if I don't draw a land, I can't re-trigger Ruin Crab. That's good. I also could have, I guess, tapped everything at the end of the turn and then try to play like Lurrus and find another Mesmeric Orb. But drawing the Oboro puts me in good shape regardless. All right, feels like my opponent had to get pretty unlucky for me to win that one. Like beating Reanimator with Mill when I haven't drawn a Graveyard Hate card shouldn't happen all that often, but it did happen that game. So here I definitely want the Surgical and the Four Soul Guides. Remember, Ashiok is strong, but it makes me lose Lurrus, and Lurrus has been really good. All right, I guess I'll just try this. Right, Ensnaring Bridge also makes me lose Lurrus. I think it would have been reasonable to keep Fatal Push into my deck, but I think I had more than 60 cards that I was pretty happy with there. I don't know. In a previous game, I waited till turn two to play Ruin Crab against Lightning Bolt. I don't know why I played it on turn one that time. That was probably not the ideal choice. I'm sure I should have just played Lantern and then had Ruin Crab for turn two. It's ambitious. Turn three, use Silent Clearing. Hey, Legacy Council, thanks for that nice message. Thanks for stopping by. All right. Okay, I think. I could draw one card. Seems safe. This thing probably just gonna kill me. So this thing has trample, and whenever it damages a creature, that creature gets exiled. I can try to attack back with my 3/2 lifelink, kind of defray the life loss. All right, interesting. So opponent has 15 cards in graveyard. I feel like if I can just get it to 20 and cash these in, then I can like get enough resources to fight this thing. Closer. Montefiore, thanks for the sub. Yeah, go ahead and search that library. Love it. Love it. Okay, so we're in a archive trap first. I actually didn't even need to do that necessarily because they were up to 20. Now I'm going to visions. Visions. Just persist in hand for my opponent. That should do it, right? Beautiful. Hello, Canister. Thank you for the raid, Canister. Welcome to all Canister people. Currently playing blue-black mill. I'm 2-1 in the Modern League. Teggy, thank you so much for your continued support. All the regulars extending their subscriptions today. I love it. A lot of gift subs. One cheer. Thanks, everybody. I lost extremely badly to Blue Red Delver. Extremely badly. Good games, Mad Robot. Thanks for stopping by the stream. And thank you, Steve, for subscribing. Ricardo says, we should make sure to have a lantern in play when you go for the lethal mill in case they sideboard, they have a Gaia's Blessing or an Emrakul or something. That is a great suggestion, and I'll try to act on that in the future, but in that particular case I had surgical extraction and I knew there were not going to be any surprises. This hand is, I mean, lands and Hedron Crab is definitely a decent start. Surgical extraction is one of the, well, the weakest card in the deck as a standalone, and then I have a few too many lands, so it's kind of borderline. I think I'm just going to keep it on the strength of like Hedron Crab and Polluted Delta and Oboro and stuff, but fairly close decision. Hey, Whirlywind. Whirlwind, thank you so much for the raid. Welcome to everyone who's coming from Whirlwind's channel. All right, my opponent has mulliganed to 5. Probably a strategic mulligan to increase their starting hit points library size. Only thing I know about my opponent's hand is basic forest, and keep in mind they started on 5 cards. Yes, okay. There's the Titan. Okay, so I think the move is I pass, I draw step, surgical the Titan, and then I Field of Ruin the Sanctuary. Okay, that's enough. My opponent has seen enough. So I'm losing Larissa's companion this time. I've been resistant to do that, but I think Ashiok's strong enough in this matchup that it's worthwhile. I don't think this is a deck where you should put Luris in your main deck. It's like really great to have as a companion, but not something that I would necessarily want to draw and invest mana into instead of just having another mill card. Do I have main deck surgical extractions? Three main, one sideboard. Okay, I'm gonna throw this one back. Not enough lands and not enough crabs. And I still don't like that I have only one land, but I will be keeping this rather than go to five. Yeah, sure. I think I'll just bottom. I don't know. Bottom Hedron Crab. Yep. How about a land? Land, please. Arasta of the Endless Web. Fascinating. Steve writes, what's the thinking there to not hold the mana for next turn for the double mill? So you're saying I should not, you're suggesting that I would not make my land drop there. I think it's just too important to spend your mana efficiently and like, you know, prioritize board presence over just getting a few extra points of mill. Because if you look, I have all two mana spells in my hand, right? So if I make, if I don't make my land drop and then next turn I go crab land, then I'm still going to have all these two mana spells in my hand that I'm struggling to deploy. I think I'm okay with this. Chooses non-land, hits Primeval Titan. Got it. Yeah, I think I'm okay with this too. They didn't search this turn, did they? I don't think they've searched at all. All right, go ahead. So just one Titan in hand for my opponent. So Counterspell is doing a good job of holding things down. Yeah, I guess I pass again. They could actually use Sunholm. Which I guess is fine. Wow, really? Just discarding the hand size? All right, I mean, I can play these and just let the Titan kill me. I guess that's fine. Or I could play the orb and get a little more information about how my opponent sideboarded. Let's do that. So I'm effectively just conceding this game, but I'll get to see seven more cards. Hornet Queen. All right, so no big surprises. This is supposed to be my good matchup, and I won game one, so let's just get a nice three land hand this time. Function smoothly. Yeah, that looks like it'll function smoothly. Opponent starts on six. Yep. What would I say are the weak matchups for Mill? So far, my experience has been kind of like the more normal the deck, the harder the matchup. So I lost badly to Delver earlier. I think stuff like Golgari and Jund are bad matchups, but if they're playing a combo strategy or a control strategy, it's usually a lot better for Mill. Okay, a mill to Titan. That's good. Explore. I mean, I could just counterspell this or drown in the lock. Could also let it go. I will let it go. So, yeah, I mean, there's always a lot of discussion about when to cast Surgical and on what. But if the idea is ever like, I'm gonna hope I get lucky and they just randomly have a copy of a card that I've milled, that's usually not gonna be my plan. I'm gonna use it either after I've seen their hand or on a key piece. Like, for example, my goal is to Surgical Titan on the turn that they're gonna hit six mana. Not to just like guess at what they've drawn so far. Okay, you would like to cast Summoner's Pact. You may cast Summoner's Pact. Here's my opponent's graveyard currently. So they searched for Arasta of the Endless Web. I milled a second Titan. And I think I'm just going to pass the turn here. Oh no, I should Archive Trap. All right, so now I'm going to pass and they're going to pay for the Summoner's Pact. Use Drown to play around Bojuka Bog. You're absolutely right. I actually had thought of that and intended to use Drown, but then I just when it actually came to it, I used Counterspell instead. But you're absolutely right. And I had thought about that earlier and decided that that was a better play. Okay, I guess we'll go for draw step extraction on Titan. That was the plan after all. So their hand has a Titan, got lucky there. Their library, sorry, I got a bunch of windows open here. Their library doesn't really have any major surprises. In fact, only one Dryad remaining as a creature in the library. So I'm going to take away these Titans. Then I'm going to extract the Dryad. And then we really won't have that much to worry about. Hopefully counter the Arasta. Yeah, in fact, I think if I counter this Arasta, my opponent doesn't have any remaining ways to deal damage. Now, strangely, I want to not activate that because Drown in the Lock is my answer card. Sure. Like I said, if I just kill this thing, I don't think I can lose. So I'll take the approach of winning slower. Is killing Boros Garrison better there? I don't know. I didn't memorize whether they have more red sources in their library, but their total amount of mana doesn't matter anymore. Okay, I think I can just play Ashiok, mill for three, mill for four, and then they're dead next turn deterministically. Oh, alternatively, I could Ashiok first and then Crab, which is what I should have done, but oh well. Not a big deal. I guess I actually like the worst thing that could have happened would be if my opponent had drawn the other prismatic ending. I still like there's probably not a combination of cards that could come off the top of the library where where they would win, but that's something that I should have thought about. Okay, one more to go. Eldrazi Tron. I played and wrote about Eldrazi Tron probably about a year ago, but at some point in 2020, I made an Eldrazi Tron video. Okay, my matchups. I have defeated Amulet Titan, a Cascade Glimpse of Tomorrow deck, and Reanimator, and I've lost to Blue Red Delver. Here we go. Match number five. Snow-covered island pass. Interesting. Force of Negation, Mutavault, Botanical Sanctum. What do we have here? Maybe like Merfolk, blue-green Merfolk. Okay, that's Cavern of Souls, naming Merfolk. Can't be countered, so it is what it is. They might have Harbinger that bounces my tapped creature, but I think I'm going to do this anyway. Just another trickster, sure. I was going to grab Swamp, but I think maybe Island is better now that I think about it. Lord of Atlantis. I guess I'll throw a counterspell at that. Ooh, I can't believe it worked. But there is another Lord of Atlantis, so I'm taking a big hit here. Then I have to try to drown the Lord. Some kind of irony in that, drowning a merfolk. Yikes. So Drown, Vision, Encrypt Incursion, these are all strong cards. But unfortunately, I cannot play more than one in a turn. I also, it's just not legal for me to activate Field of Ruin because my opponent has all basic lands. So, I mean, am I cashing in the Visions of Beyond right now for just one card? If I drown and they have Force of Negation, I'm dead. But I can't beat Force of Negation anyway. All right, I guess I'll just cast this. Is that right? Think so. As indestructible, as long as you control at least two other merfolk. When it attacks, draw a card. Other merfolk have ward one. Okay. They have Chalice of the Void. Oh, baby, 48 life. Okay, so I know it's difficult for y'all to see my graveyard, but I exiled Silvergill Adept, Master of the Pearl Trident, Four Lord of Atlantis, Tide Shaper, Svealun, Second Master of the Pearl Trident, Four Merfolk Mistbinders, and their remaining graveyard, they have two Force of Negations, a bunch of lands, Vial, Chalice. All right, Crypt Incursion gets the job done. I think this is probably an Ensnaring Bridge matchup. Take out Counterspell just seems pretty clunky. Maybe Archive Trap is bad too. That's talk about clunky. I don't particularly want to board in Lyris. I don't think it's very effective to draw. It's not like Merfolk deck's going to be killing my crabs. I mean, Counterspell is okay. It's so bad against Vial and so bad against Cavern. I don't know. I guess I'll just try to do the Field of Ruin Archive Trap thing, that's fine. Really, really good hand. Just what I want. No, I don't have anything to remove Chalice if it hits the battlefield. Well, this thing stays a 1-1 if I can avoid playing an island. I don't know how long I can do that for. All right, Force of Negation, pitching Force of Negation. Zero cards in hand for opponent. I can't really stop the 4 or 6 damage that's coming in per turn, but hopefully Profane Memento and eventually Crypt Incursion can help. Oboro is actually pretty huge here. All right, that's going to stop me from casting the other Profane Memento. Yep, I take the 6. So, notably, Spell Pierce is turned off. So what do I think about casting this? What do I think about casting this? What do I think about cycling this? I think casting Fractured Sanity is where I want to be. This should, you know, on average, gain me like 6 or so life. Ooh, more than 6. Okay. And then Oboro is just amazing here, guaranteeing the land drop every turn. No attack with the Mutavault. So that's gotta mean Force of Negation, right? Is there like anything else it can be? The 4th copy of Force of Negation? So I think the plan is going to be end of turn, cast the Crypt Incursion, untap, cast Fractured Sanity. Because basically, if either one of those resolves, my opponent's going to be, hard pressed to win the game. All right, as expected, it's the fourth Force of Negation. And now, with four cards in their library, even just cycling this should be good enough. Right. I would have expected that to be a really tough matchup, but I just had good draws. It worked out, and that's 4-1 with Modern Mill. Yeah, I think this is a strong overall deck, and particularly strong for certain metagames. Like if you expect to face fewer creatures and more of Titan, Tron, combo, cascade type stuff, Mill can be a really good place to be. I also like this particular Profane Memento sideboard plan. I think that's maybe not so effective against bigger creatures, but against like plain burn or it was even strong against Merfolk there, some small creature tribal decks. That's really appealing. If I was to consider changing anything about this list, I thought there was a tension that I didn't love between boarding in Ashiok and Ensnaring Bridge and losing Lurrus. Like, Lurrus is really good, and Ashiok and Ensnaring Bridge are really good also, but the idea of bringing one or two cards into my deck in exchange for losing my really powerful companion seemed like it was, yeah, just a uncomfortable tension. And maybe if you could just switch these for cards that don't conflict with Lurrus in the sideboard, like extra copies of Fatal Push or whatever it might be. We had suggestions for Mystical Dispute and Aether Gust. That would be good as well. All right, cool. That's all I've got for today. I'm gonna wrap up the stream a little bit early. On the way out, we're gonna raid Aspiring Spike. But thanks everyone for a great stream. Lots of subscribers and gift subs and a cheer or two. I appreciate all that. And have a great rest of the day.